You know, in our quest to get you all the big voices as far as the COVID-19 crisis in India is concerned, today we are joined by eminent virologist Dr. Pradeep Seth. So thanks very much for taking time out. And I want to first begin by the million-dollar question, sir. Is India flattening the COVID-19 curve? Because that's the question on everyone's mind right now. And there have been a lot of conflicting statements coming in from ICMR, AIIMS, and the health ministry. As from a virologist point of view, sir, are you of the belief that India is flattening the curve?
See, if you see the total number of cases, which is announced by the ICMR, because they are the only source in India which is giving the number of cases. There are 7 states which account for more than almost 60-70% of the cases. And rest of the places, there's hardly any. You know, there are some states which are absolutely free. So you cannot see the flattening of the curve in that sense, because it's very upheaval sort of thing. You understand it. There are some states which are giving a lot of cases. There are some states which are not. There's hardly anything. Ahmedabad, for example, has got a lot of cases, right? Mm-hmm. Delhi, again, there's a number is increasing. And day before yesterday, the chief minister of Delhi announced that now we should know how to live with the COVID. And I think that should be the attitude, that we have to know how to live with COVID. So flattening of the curve means, the question is, I still feel the worst is yet to come. As director of AIIMS, Dr. Randeep Guleria, who incidentally was my student also, he's a very sharp person. And he said it, yes, I mean, I agree with him when he said the worst has to come. Uh-huh. In the sense, June and July, the things will be much more severe.
Okay.
Right, okay.
Okay. June and July is what, when we're looking for the curve to peak?
Yeah. The curve to peak. That's what is expected. But the question is, what happens? That we have to know how to tackle this. As if you see the total epidemiology or the number of cases in different places, there are some hot spots in a particular city, 1 or 2 or 10, or 1, 2, 5, 6, whatever number is, there are some which are not. Hmm. Right. So you cannot just put everything in one basket. In hot spots, you have to have, absolutely, you have to close everything down. For example, today I heard in the news, in the evening news, that Gandhinagar, they have absolutely 100% shut down. Only milk and chemists are available. Mm. And not even grocery shop, nothing. Gandhinagar is in Ahmedabad, you know, the capital. So that type of situation has to be there in order to tackle this situation. Because otherwise, it will be very, the things may go out of hand. By the way, unless we have some program, the vaccine is yet a far cry. It's a far cry, okay? And people are...
But sir, because I think again that's the big question on everyone's mind. We saw some development. Israel said that we have identified the antibody. I suppose even Italy said that we have had some breakthrough, some success. In your assessment, how far are we from the vaccine?
You see, firstly, we have to know what is the protective arm of this virus. So vaccines which are injectable, you understand it. Mm-hmm. They may not protect you completely. They may tune down your infection, you know, like, you know, from moderate to mild or severe to moderate, but they will not protect you completely. This is what has been seen with other viruses also, those who are, which are respiratory viruses. Secondly, we do not know much about immunopathogenesis of this virus also. Mm-hmm. We do not know what role does the antibody play. As a result, if you make a vaccine with one particular virus, one particular strain, and there's a mutation occurs. What happens in influenza similarly was similar to what happens in influenza virus. There's a mutation. If there's a mutation, the antibodies produced by the previous infection will may not protect the against the current.
With that in mind, how long, what time period are we looking at for a vaccine to come up?
Okay, now what type of vaccine? That's another very good question, which injectable vaccine, I am not very sure whether it will have any reason. There should be a vaccine which can be given by nasal route. What I believe, nip the virus where it enters. Usual vaccine development takes about 6 to 8 years. I'll give you the example, the HIV vaccine, which I developed in 2003 and 2004, and I tried it on myself also, that particular vaccine. It's still undergoing toxicity testing and also before human trials. It takes such a long time. So the Prime Minister said that we have to cut down, and cut down there means about in a couple of years it should be ready. I'm also developing a testing kit. You know, these are real-time PCR is being used. That's expensive. And every lab cannot afford to do it. And naturally, very few tests have been done, you know, every state. You understand it. For the Absolutely. Population, you can. So I have developed a test. I mean, I'm in the process of developing tests. That particular technique, which I developed in 2008, that does not require sophisticated equipment. That requires a PCR machine, a small PCR machine, and an ELISA reader. That's it. And that can do what I believe. I mean, this is my conjecture, total, okay? We Indians have some sort of immunity, whether it is immunity from the past, from not from COVID-19, but from other infections, other human coronavirus infection or something else. Some other we have, see, on the whole, the total scenario of the disease has not been very severe. You know, for example, the people are suffering from mild to moderate. Very few people are from the severe, with the severe disease. Very few people, as compared to in the Western countries. My friends in USA complained of this, that we have got a lot of cases which are severe. So that may be the reasons, whether it is genetic predisposition.
I think that's a good news, sir. I think it's a good thing that India is reporting lower death rates. But I also want to know from you, sir, where do we stand as opposed to, you know, the global trends in coronavirus? We are at 60,000 plus, as I mentioned. Where do you think India stands currently when you compare it to other countries at the same number when other countries were reporting some 60,000, 50,000 plus cases?
See, with the population of India, if you see, don't say the total number of cases. Take what is the ratio. Okay. Number of cases over the total population. You'll find we are very low as compared to other countries. Right? So don't go in the number of cases. Now, India has got 60,000 cases. Pakistan doesn't have that much. Or Bangladesh doesn't have it. No. Fine, the total, take from the total population, what ratio of the population has got, right, first. So what I believe that in time to come, India will be the first country in which the coronavirus will be controlled.
Okay.
Will be controlled, it will gradually, I still feel that, although initially I thought that it'll disappear by May 31st, but no, I think now it should go by September, October, definitely. Okay. By before, much before, your USA will, they are expecting the second peak in way back in September, October, November in US. But in India, I think we should be able to control it. But let's see.
So I last question, sir, before I let you be, a lot of conspiracy theories, especially after the China versus US war on where the virus originates from. Was it made in laboratory? Was it human made? in your assessment, sir, is this virus
let me ask you, is it used
in a lab?
Okay, let me ask you one thing. Where will I get money? Which group will pay me money? If I say cancer, yes.
But maybe US can fund yours.
US is in a poor state at present. See, that's it's very difficult to say at present, frankly speaking, right? Unless if there's a suspicion, I believe in one thing, if there's a suspicion, the lab should be screened. Should be all, because see, there's a lady, I forgot her name, who has been working, I'll give you her this. She was in 2014, was it 2014? Yeah. She was a postdoc fellow in France, working in some viruses with that, and annual virus. She came down next in China and started working with bat viruses. And every year she has been publishing about 5 or 6. And if you follow her papers, they were all related to different genes and everything. So it's very difficult to say, if you see. So that that arouses suspicion, no doubt. But it's very difficult to say. It's very difficult to say.
But
one thing I can tell you, for a good molecular biologist, okay, uh-huh. And the rogue molecular biologist, not a sensible rogue molecular biologist, it's not difficult to create a monster. It's not difficult to create.
So you're saying it's not difficult to create?
To create monster, because you know so many, that because of genetic engineering, things are so, it's like a good molecular biologist can take this gene out of this and put it here and that, exactly, okay, right? This type of thing can happen. So at least I don't believe in that particular thing. And I always say that if the conscience should be, if I have become a molecular scientist, if I have become a doctor, it's for the public. Not to harm them, but to give them something.
Right.
That's what it
is. Thanks very much for your time. Thank you for sparing your good time for this conversation with us. We really appreciate you joining us.
Thank you very much.